I'm Dr. Shivakumar from NIMS, Hyderabad. Today's my topic is surgical management of iatrogenic occlusive disease. In that open anatomical reconstruction is my topic today. The British anatomist and surgeon John Hunter first appreciated the implications of aortic bifurcation occlusive disease in the late 1700s. His dissection specimens remain on view at Hunter Museum in London. And it laid the groundwork for Lehrig to understand the disease process, and later he proposed the Lehrig syndrome. The modern era of reconstruction for complex atherosclerotic occlusive disease began in 1947 with endarterectomy by Dos Santos. He performed CFA endarterectomy. Later, Wheely et al. And extended this technique to aortoiliac disease. Later, it was transferred to aorto bifemoral grafting after the invention of synthetic grafts. Early preference to aortoiliac grafting would be eventually supplanted by more durable aorto bifemoral bypass procedure. So when it comes to disease epidemiology, it is divided into isolated and multi-level occlusive disease depending upon the age pattern. In isolated disease comes in younger patient, and multi-level occlusive disease occurs in more in older group people. Younger patient present with smoking and hypercholesterolemia. Older patients present with diabetes and hypertension are the risk factors. There is equal incidence in male and female in isolated disease, and males are more common in presented in multi-level disease. In isolated aortic occlusive disease, patient present with intermittent claudication involving the thighs, hip, or buttocks. They have normal expectancy. In multi-level occlusive disease, they are present with more severe disease like CTLI, rest pain, ischemia, gangrene. So these patients have reduced life expectancy due to other comorbidities like coronary artery disease or cerebrovascular disease. Presenting symptoms are like a regular peripheral arterial disease, maybe present with a critical limb ischemia or maybe a claudicant. Up to 30% of the affected males may present with erectile dysfunction due to involvement of decreased perfusion to internal pudendal arteries. In men, well-characterized constellation of symptoms known as Lehrig syndrome, like terminal aortic occlusion causing claudication, atrophy of leg muscles, impotence, and reduced femoral pulses. There is another entity, small aortic syndrome or hypoplastic aortic syndrome, seen in young women who smoke. In this, aorta is atretic and narrowed with diffuse calcific atherosclerotic changes. Frequently, focal stenosis is found posteriorly at the proximal aortic bifurcation. Such patients have extensive smoking history, but may lack other typical atherosclerotic risk factors. The diminutive size of aorta and iliac vessels has very important treatment implications in such patients, because endovascular intervention and local endarterectomy results are very poor, and because in the presence of continued cigarette use. Pathology begins at the aortic dimness and common iliac artery origins and slowly progress proximal and distally. One third of the patients with symptomatic aortic occlusive disease have significant orificial profunda femoris occlusive disease, and more than 40% have a significant SFA disease. Disease can also extend to the level of renal arteries. In one third of the patient with aortic occlusion, went on to develop renal artery thrombosis in the next 5 to 10 years period. Because of the in focal aortic occlusive disease, my patient will present with only claudication due to abundant collateralization, which reconstitute the infraangular system with sufficient flow to ensure adequate resting tissue perfusion. The primary compensatory networks include lumbar hypergastric feeding vessels and connect to circumflex iliac, hypergastric, femoral, and profunda recipients. Other pathways include intermammary inferior epigastric pathway and also visceral pathway, include mesenteric and superior mesenteric and inferior mesenteric pathway. The superior inferior mesenteric visceral pathway include arcorialon and marginal meandering artery. It is important to recognize these during surgery, because damage of such leads to future limb ischemia if the graft gets occluded. These are the collateral pathways. They can be divided into systemosystemic, vasorosystemic, and visceral pathways. In the systemosystemic pathways is mediated by the intercostal and lumbar arteries and internal thoracic and interior peripheric gastric arteries joining to the deep circumflex femoral artery and iliolumbar arteries. So vasorosystemic and visceral pathways are mainly mediated by the SMA, IMA, and superior humeroidal arteries. Diagnosis mainly by history and physical examination. Patient will have multiple risk factors, claudication, option femoral pulses, diagnosis of iatrogenic disease is generally straightforward. Proximal muscle groups are generally involved. Some patient may present with atrophic muscles, due to disuse in claudicans, but the lower extremities frequently appear well perfused at rest. Femoral and even deep pulses may be palpable at rest, reflecting the presence of robust collateral networks. Pulses may diminish or become absent only after exercise. Similarly, palpable thrill or audible breathe at the lower abdominal or groin level may also become detectable after exertion. Coming to assessment, there are regular non-invasive segmental blood pressure measurements and pulse volume recordings help to confirm your clinical diagnosis of peripheral arterial disease and also define the level of and degree of occlusion. So resting pressure difference sometimes between the upper limbs and lower limbs defines a general aortic iliac lesion, but it may be confirmed by proximal SFA occlusion. Further reduction in pressure between thigh and ankle suggests that concomitant femoropopliteal tibial vessel disease. Patient with disabling symptoms with normal or near normal resting ABA, repeat measurements after provocative exercise grading or treadmill testing can be done. Diagnostic imaging for planning the management include duplex imaging, axial imaging like CT angiography, MR angiography, or arteriography can also be done. Indications for intervention are like a chronic limb-threatening ischemia and lifestyle-limiting claudication. Chronic limb-threatening ischemia. It is associated with more significant risk of amputation without revascularization. As such, the presence of ischemic rest pain, frank ulceration, distal ganglion are well accepted indications for surgical correction in iatrogenic occlusive disease. Patients with pre-ganglionous skin changes or frank ganglion typically have hemodynamic infra-ganglionic disease as well as iatrogenic disease. Patients present treated for claudication or rest pain usually required only a single stage inflow operation. Simultaneous or staged inflow and outflow revascularization should be considered in patients with a tissue loss. Claudication is a relative indication for intervention. Majority of the claudicans demonstrate a stable pattern of disease and have an improvement in symptoms as a result of risk factor modification. 20 to 30% may require operation in the next 5 years as a result of progression. Annual rate of mortality and limb loss are around 5% and 1% respectively. Patients of low surgical risk with disabling claudication from disease limited to the aorta bifurcal segment, intervention is an appropriate option. Current levels of perioperative morbidity and mortality, bypass can be undertaken safely and with the expectation of excellent long-term patency. In the management of iatrogenic occlusive disease, there comes the percutaneous and surgical interventions. A significant paradigm shift has been occurred in the treatment of peripheral arterial disease. Angioplasty and stenting have become the first-line therapy for most patients with iatrogenic disease. Percutaneous treatment of aorta and iliac arteries was previously limited to short segment, task A and B lesions. It is now routinely applied to even task C and D lesions. Extensive calcification of the aortic bifurcation is thought to be a risk of rupture with balloon angioplasty. And also disease extending into CFA because of the need of longer stent is unsuitable for endovascular approach previously. With the introduction of low-profile covered stents, risk of rupture is reduced, and hybrid approaches within which CFA plaque is treated with traditional endarterectomy and patch repair of the iliac component is concurrently addressed with the endovascular techniques. The task classification. Now, the comes of role of open surgery in endovascular era. In the current era in which direct reconstruction of iatrogenic disease has been relegated to a second or third line therapy, open bypass increase in undertaken patient with failed endovascular therapy or in those patients with extensive disease that an endovascular approach is deemed inadvisable. So patient with early recurrence of iatrogenic disease after angioplasty and stenting represent a growing group of population in whom surgical repair may be indicated. Patient with a significant renal failure in whom endovascular therapy fails, risk of triggering dialysis dependence. Complications of endovascular treatment include dissection, vessel rupture, are infrequent indication for surgical reconstruction. Distal edema from aortic iliac source, typically from ulcerated edematous plaque or shaggy aorta, represent another group in which operative reconstruction is indicated and prevent of recurrent embolization. Nowadays, this can be dealt with a covered grafts. Combination of proximal aneurysmal disease and common extensive iliac occlusive disease continue to be good candidates for open reconstruction, although this group will continue to diminish with the ongoing technological advancements. Studies have documented a general excellent outcomes of aorta bifurcal grafting in elderly patients who are otherwise good risk patients, suggesting that surgical therapy should not be withheld. Conversely, low long-term patency rates with aorta bypass in young patients or those with small aortic diameters suggest caution for considering early surgical intervention in such patients. Surgical treatment is divided into direct anatomical repair and extra anatomical repair. In direct anatomical repair, we have aorta femoral bypass grafting and aorta iliac endarterectomy. Extra anatomical, we have axillo femoral bypass. Aorta iliac endarterectomy, the first successful endarterectomy was of the CFA was done by Dal Santos. After multiple failed attempts, after the discovery of heparin, he achieved a success. Wheely et al. Soon extended this technique to the level of aorta iliac in 1950 and 1960. Endarterectomy was standard of therapy for severe aorta iliac disease in this period. Enthusiasm for procedure dimmed, however, with the introduction of prosthetic graft material 10 years later, and aorta iliac endarterectomy was largely replaced by bypass grafting. Endarterectomy offers several theoretical advantages in conditions like no prosthetic in this condition, no prosthetic material inserted. In such like infections where prosthetic material cannot be introduced, this can be used. Inflow to the hypogastric arteries is not limited in this technique. So potentially improving the sexual potency in the male and it perhaps somewhat better than with the bypass procedures. In conditions like reoperation in a contaminated or infected fields, endarterectomy can be offered. Endarterectomy is contraindicated in aneurysmal disease because post-surgery, the aorta may be continued to degenerate. In juxtarenal occlusion of the aorta, simple transection of the aorta below the renal arteries and thrombectomy of the aortic cuff followed by bypass grafting is more beneficial than endarterectomy alone. Disease involving the iliac arteries, which are smaller in size, greater length, are more difficult exposure and are more muscular and with adherent medial layer, are well documented to have higher incidence of both early thrombosis and iliac failure as a result of restenosis. Extended aorta femoral endarterectomy procedures have been generally abandoned and replaced by aorta bifrenal bypass procedure. Aorta iliac endarterectomy is more demanding than bypass procedures. Endarterectomy is more feasible and durable when it is applied to focal stenotic lesions in vessels with larger caliber and high flow. Particularly efficacious in localized disease limited to distal aorta or proximal common iliac artery and excellent long-term patency rate on part with aorta bypass grafting have been reported. Patient selection of endarterectomy is important. Disease should be terminate at or just beyond the common iliac artery bifurcation, allowing the surgeon to achieve satisfactory endpoint without extending more than 1 to 2 centimeters into the external iliac segment. In the setting of infection, to eliminate the need for prosthetic graft. Young patients are those with smaller vessels who are less ideal candidates for endovascular grafting or aorta bifrenal bypass procedures. Patients with erectile dysfunction attributable to proximal hypogastric occlusive disease are well suited for this approach. Technique of endarterectomy, it is a direct disoperative debulking technique that takes advantage of the pathological localization of the atherosclerotic disease to the intimate media. Typically, cleavage plane can be by Hamavasi characterized the cleavage planes into three types, subintimal, transmedial, and subadvertential. In his view, the last two planes are preferred because subintimal plane predisposes to subsequent thrombosis. The residual outer layer is generally of sufficient mechanical strength to hold surgical sutures and to resist disruption or progressive enlargement when subject to arterial pressure. Rarely, residual adventitia may also be attenuated that reconstruction of the wall with the patch or with the extreme cases as interposition graft may be necessary. Tacking sutures should be used when necessary, particularly to secure the rich endpoint to prevent flap dissection. In this picture, we can see the aorta iliac endarterectomy. Here, the incision is directly over the aorta, extending it to one common iliac artery. When giving incision the opposite common iliac artery, there's a small segment of the bridge should be left and given incision going over the common iliac artery. Endarterectomy can be done through this incision and either closed with either primary patch repair or a primary repair. Aorta bifrenal bypass grafting. So in the patient is prepared, this is a major surgery. Patient is, as we take for a regular major surgery, blood is prepared, adequate hydration preoperatively, antibiotics, and patient is positioned supine position with arms extended, radial arteries cannulation to monitor the BP and ABG, and central venous catheterization. Patient with generally use of epidural, combined epidural and general anesthesia, and intraoperative prevent of hypothermia is needed. The surgery starts with generally with the exposure of the femoral vessels. the initial vascular exposure and control are attained before institution of systemic anticoagulation to prevent blood loss. The femoral vessels are typically exposed through the bilateral longitudinal or oblique incisions to reduce the time during which abdomen open and to limit the fluid and heat loss. Groin incisions are oriented slightly obliquely and placed so that the cephaloid 1/3 of the incision lies above the inguinal ligament. Distal extent of the incision involves circumferential control of the proximal SFA and the profunda femoris artery. And proximal extent is the transition between external iliac artery and common femoral artery marked by the inferior epigastric and circumflex iliac branches. During resection of the groin, lymph nodes and lymphatic should be suture ligated to prevent postoperative lymphatic leak and infection. Caudal part of the inguinal ligament is partially cut to provide adequate space for the graft limb and prevent compression. Any sizable side branches of the femoral arteries are preserved and controlled with loops. Significant occlusive disease in the proximal profunda femoris artery on the preoperative arteriogram or by intraoperative palpation, the vessel is exposed further caudally beyond the significant disease. Exposing additional 2 to 3 cm of the vessel requires division of the profunda femoral vein that typically crosses anterior to the proximal profunda femoris artery. Circumferential femoral arterial branch is frequently arises from the posterior aspect of the distal common femoral artery. It must be controlled and to avoid troublesome back bleeding. Abdominal incision is generally, it can be a midline laparotomy incision or a transverse incision. Peritoneum, we can approach it transperitoneally or retroperitoneally. Retroperitoneal approach can be employed and may be advantageous in obese patients as well as those patients with a hostile abdomen or previous aortic surgeries. Exposure of the infrarenal abdominal aorta. After the incision, abdomen is explored for any intra-abdominal abnormalities and stomach is palpated to ensure proper position of the NG tube. The transverse colon and greater omentum are elevated and retracted cephaloid. Enter small bowel is eviscerated and displaced to the right. The descending and sigmoid portions of the colon are retracted laterally and caudally. A self-explanatory retractor is applied after a sufficient care is taken to protect bowel from the blade injury. Then the posterior parietal peritoneum overlying the infernal aorta is incised along the longitudinal axis of the aorta, starting from the duodenum on the patient's right and the inferior mesenteric vein on the left. The incision extended cephaloid and the ligament of Teeg is divided to emulate the fourth part of the duodenum of the aorta. It facilitates visualization of the left renal vein crossing the anterior to the aorta. Left renal vein is important landmark because proximal graft anastomosis is placed close to it as possible to minimize the recurrent occlusive disease in the infernal aorta above the proximal anastomosis. If the renal artery reconstruction is not planned, the dissection is limited to the between the renal arteries and the IMEA. The extent is sufficient to allow reconstruction for a proper proximal graft anastomosis. Avoid injury to plexus and autonomous fibers that traverse along the left anterolateral aspect of the infrarenal aorta and proximal left common iliac artery to prevent postoperative sexual dysfunction, especially in male patients. Retroperitoneal tunnel creation. The tunnels are created between the aortic exposure and the femoral artery dissection in each groin and best performed by simultaneous blunt finger dissection from above and below. Dissection plane directly anterior to the iliac vessel so that graft limb traverses posterior to the ureter to avoid compression and obstruction. The left limb tunnel passes beneath the sigmoid mesentery and more laterally to avoid disruption of the autonomic nerve plexus. Care must be taken not to tear circumflex iliac venous branches that cross the external iliac artery just above the inguinal ligament. After tunneling, a blunt tipped clamp is passed through each tunnel and rubber Penrose drain is pulled up through the tract. Anterior traction of the drain facilitates proper passage of the graft through the after the proximal and distal dissection and control of the vessels, anticoagulation is given. So for peripheral vascular intervention, the initial dose is typically between 70 to 100 units per kg and an activated clotting time of 250 to 350 seconds range is adequate. Additional doses may be required depending upon the length of operation and requirement for additional periods of low occlusion. Clamp placement. Sites of heavy calcification should be predetermined by non-contrast CT. During intraoperative, the aorta is carefully palpated to identify the optimal site for application of cross clamps. In the event of asymmetric plaque, the technique of soft clamp against the hard plaque minimizes the risk of embolization and traumatic clamp injury in the heavily calcified aorta. Appropriate atraumatic vascular clamp selected and a sufficient time for heparin to circulate. The aorta is clamped either proximally or distally at the site of least disease to avoid dislodgement and distal embolization of the plaque. The proximal clamp is placed just below the renal arteries if the disease does not obligate the need for suprarenal clamping with a little detailed dissection of the renal artery origins as possible. The distal clamp is usually placed above or below the IMA. The thrombus are significant aortic calcification extend to the level of renal arteries. Proximal aortic dissection to the supralunar level is needed. Mobilization and cephaloid or caudate retraction of the left renal vein can facilitate adequate exposure of the juxtarenal aorta. In some cases, division of the left renal vein is needed. In such cases, adrenal, lumbar, and gonadal branches, collateral branches are preserved. If suprarenal clamping is undertaken, concurrent clamping of the renal artery is advised to prevent potential adverse effect of embolization. Alternatively, proximal control can be taken by endovascular like intraluminal balloon deployment or supraceliac clamping via gastrohepatic ligament. In all the cases, it is important to extend the reconstruction close to the level of renal arteries to minimize the risk of failure secondary to disease progression in the remaining infranenal aorta. The aorta is transected between the clamps. A short segment of the distal aortic of 3 to 4 cm is often accessed to prevent, to improve the exposure of the aortic neck and to aid precise proximal reconstruction, and allow graft to lie more flat over the vertebral column rather than the anterior orientation to facilitate retroperitoneal coverage. Any patent lumbar artery branches arising from this segment are clamped and ligated. If end-to-site repair is planned, exposure and control of the relevant lumbar arteries and axial renal arteries before the arteriotomy is performed, it helps to prevent back bleeding. The transected distal aortic end is next over soon in two layers with a 30 suture. The divided proximal end of the aorta is inspected for thrombus and loose erythematous debris. Perform a thromboendarterectomy of the aortic stem up to the level of proximal clamp. Remove all the thrombotic material and calcified plaque. Facilitate both suture placement and creation of widely patent proximal anastomosis. Brief apposition of the reposition of the proximal clamp to supranenal position or application of a digital pressure sufficient to temporarily occlude the suprarenal aorta. It may be helpful to ensure that thorough removal of all intraluminal debris. If the thrombus extending to the level of renal arteries, then renal circulation, renal arterial control is taken. Suprarenal control is briefly used, and thrombectomizing the infranenal cuff without placement of a infrarenal proximal aortic clamp, which could displace the thrombus more proximally. Generally, the aortic plaque encountered at this location is often soft, propagated, and secondary thrombus that can be easily removed, and aortic pressure is used to flush out the remaining plaque. Remnant debris is cleared from the infrarenal cuff. The aorta is flushed again, and renal arteries are backbled, and then infrarenal clamp is applied. Graft selection. A bifurcated graft appropriately sized to match the aorta and femoral valve is selected. Although some surgeons prefer PTFE, knitted Dacron grafts are more commonly used. Currently, low porosity knitted Dacron grafts have excellent handling and hemostatic properties and have proven a track record of durability. They also provide a more stable pseudoedema than earlier Owen grafts, although their tendency to dilate over time has been documented. Owen polyester grafts can also be used, but they tend to dilate less during the long-term follow-up. Greater appreciation of importance of sizing of the graft to the runoff vessels is important because early experience with graft limb thrombosis secondary to sluggish flow from the oversizing is noticed. Bifurcated grafts of measuring 18x9 or 16x8 typically chosen for male patients, 14x7 or 12x6 are for female patients. The body or stem of the bifurcated graft is cut short, leaving only 3 to 4 centimeters in length. The short body graft serves to advance the level of graft bifurcation more cephaloid to diminish the takeoff angle of the graft limbs, thereby reducing the kinking of the graft at the origin of the limbs. Then coming to anastomosis, one technical consideration related to aorta bifurcated bypass grafting has prompted considerable debate over the type of proximal anastomosis. The published literature has established that both end-to-end and end-to-site techniques are acceptable and effective. Despite strong preferences expressed by various surgeons, neither approach has demonstrated overall superiority, but each may be preferred in certain circumstances. End-to-end anastomosis facilitates comprehensive thromboendarterectomy of the proximal stem and allows better inflow pattern with less turbulence and more favorable hemodynamic characteristics. Lower rates of proximal suture line pseudoaneurysm and better long-term patency rates are reported in some series. Stapling or overseeing of the distal aorta in the end-to-end technique reduces the risk of clamp-induced emboli to the lower extremities after release of the distal clamp compared with the end-to-site technique. In this end-to-end technique, graft like flatter in the retroperitoneum enhances the ability to close the retroperitoneum over the graft, resulting in a lower rate of clot infection, graft infection and iatrogenic fistula. Concomitant aneurysmal disease and are complete aortic occlusion extending to the level of renal arteries, and end-to-end approaches should be used. Finally, the creation of end-to-side anastomosis is technically more challenging in a heavily diseased aorta, particularly if it is partially occluded by the side biting clamps. End-to-side approach, there are certain circumstances in which end-to-side proximal anastomosis is advantageous, the most common indication being a patient with occluded or severely diseased external iliac artery, but patent common in internal iliac arteries, in whom interruption of forward aortic flow may result in pelvic hypoperfusion. Additional ischemic complications such as erectile dysfunction in men, and rarely seen complications like paraplegia secondary to cardiac venous syndrome, can be potentially avoided with an end-to-side approach. Preservation of either large IMA sometimes necessary to avert colonic or mesenteric ischemia, and also it is important to preserve accessory renal arteries arising from the distal aorta or an iliac artery. Alternatively, these can be re-implanted onto the side of an end-to-end graft. Is the configurations of an end-to-end technique and end-to-side configuration. End-to-end anastomosis, the main body of the graft is shortened to minimize the graft redundancy. The anastomosis is performed with 3-0 polypropylene suture. If an end-to-side anastomosis is to be performed, a beveled anastomosis is fashioned after a approximately 3 cm longitudinal arteriotomy created as close to the renal arteries as practical. Care is taken to remove all loose debris and mural thrombi from the extruded portion of the aorta, and particular effort is made to ensure adequate back flushing of the clot and debris before re-establishing forward flow in the native aorta and graft. Side biting clamps are best avoided in end-to-side anastomosis because they compress the aortic sylvus, rendering more both adequate thromboendarterectomy and accurate suture placement more difficult. After completion of the abdominal portion of the procedure, the graft limbs are clamped and soft jaw insert clamps are insert clamps and flushed with heparin saline. The graft limbs are then passed to retroperitoneal tunnels, in which care is taken to prevent twisting or eliminate excessive redundancy, and attention is turned to the distal anastomosis. It is important to alert the anesthesia team before clamp release, given the expected pressure drop with the reperfusion. For those patients with normal femoral and distal runoff, longitudinal arteriotomy limited to CFA is sufficient. The distal anastomosis are completed in a beveled end-to-side fashion with a 5-0 polypropylene, again carrying out retrograde and anterograde flushing maneuvers before anastomosis are completed and flow is restored. Closure. Before wound closure, the surgeon should confirm the adequate distal perfusion and absence of distal embolization. If revascularization is deemed satisfactory and no further distal revascularization is to be undertaken, the effect of heparin can be reversed by administering protamine sulfate at the surgeon's discretion to help to attain hemostasis. Once the hemostasis is sufficient, the abdomen is irrigated and retroperitoneum closed over the proximal anastomosis and the graft behind the duodenum to the possible extent. If adequate retroperitoneal coverage is not possible, particularly in the end-to-side proximal anastomosis, a sleeve of omentum should be fashioned to cover the exposure graft for the exposed segment of the anastomosis. It is important to track down the omental operon to prevent small bowel herniation. The groin wounds are copiously irrigated and the deeper tissue is closed in several layers with absorbable vicryl sutures. Exgent to profendoplasty. The role of profendoplasty in preserving the long-term patency of the anatomic or extra anatomic graft is important with iatrogenic iliac occlusive disease. The patients with normal SFA and PF, profundofemoris artery, the distal anastomosis can be performed to CFA. However, most patients with iatrogenic iliac disease undergoing iatrobifurcation grafting have both profunda and SFA disease that limits the outflow and increase the likelihood of graft thrombosis. The need for exgent to profundoplasty should be determined at the time of preoperative angiography. In such patients, concomitant profundoplasty may be sufficient to sustain the patency of inflow graft and to salvage the limb, particularly if there is a good profunda collateral circulation to the patent popliteal artery. Some others recommend that distal anastomosis be extended to the profunda in every patient because the orifacial profunda disease, functional obstruction is noted in the orifice of the profunda in around 50% stenosis in these patients. Although this position has not been universally adopted, it is now common practice to extend the hood of the distal anastomosis over the horizontal profunda to enhance the graft outflow, particularly the SFA is occluded or severely diseased. In the presence of significant CFA or the profunda femoris origin plot, the endarterectomy or profundoplasty is almost always indicated. Segmental pressure gradients are used to identify the need for any profundoplasty or distal bypass in this patient preoperatively. So we calculate either profundo-popliteal collateral index or combined pressure gradient pressure index. So profundo-popliteal collateral index less than 0.25, obviously the need for distal bypass or profundoplasty. If it is more than 2.5, that it needs either a profundoplasty or a distal bypass. A technique of profundoplasty, that the profunda is usually exposed by distal extension of the incision for CFA dissection, although a lateral approach to a fresh tissue plane with a medial retraction of the sartorius can be used to avoid discarded infected groin. Dissection is continued along the anterior aspect of the artery. The extent is guided by the location of the suitable endpoint as identified by palpation and inspection and in reference to preoperative angiogram. The lateral circumflex femoral vein coursing deep to the SFA and crossing anteriorly over the profunda must be ligated in most cases. Every effort should be made to spare all collateral branches arising from the CFA or profunda femoris to preserve lower limb extension perfusion in the event of lateral graft thrombosis. Once exposed, the CFA and profunda femoris should be palpated to gauge the degree of atherosclerotic plaque, particularly given the pre-op angiography to underestimate the extent of the disease. Profunda arterial plaque is commonly ends at the first or second major branch point. And the profunda orifice can be inspected after the CFA is incised. Its lumen can be further assessed by noting the quality of back bleeding and by gentle interrogation with a series of metal probes. Isolated orificial plaque can be removed with the eversion technique through the CFA. If it becomes necessary to extend the arteriotomy to the profunda, avoid incision of the crotch of the superficial deep femoral arteries. After extensive endarterectomy, it is preferred to go to endarterectomy with a vein or bovine pericardial patch onto which distal anastomosis can be reattached rather than to create a long profunda patch with the graft limb. If an outflow bypass procedure is planned, this can be taken from the distal patch or the graft limb. We can show the incision of the profunda, CFA extending into the profunda, and it is closed with a patch repair. The graft limb is long beveled to make a hood of appropriate length and extend onto the profunda. Isolated profundoplasty. The profunda circulation is frequently spared and in the setting of severe obliterative disease of the both IOT iliac and FP segments. Profunda occlusive disease is often limited to orifice or the proximal segment. The unique role of profunda in maintaining collateral perfusion, even in the presence of proximal profunda disease to more distal segment beyond the obstruction. In extreme cases, these pathways can serve as a sole limb sustaining bridge between pelvic and abdominal wall inflow vessels proximally and geniculate vessels connections distally. However, in some diabetic patients, the profunda disease is more diffuse and distal collaterals are minimal. Effective alternative to profundoplasty is an effective alternative to either balloon angioplasty or surgical bypass of the SFA. It is particularly useful when infected infrainguinal grafts require removal or in the setting of failed bypass grafts when suitable autogenous conduit is absent and redo surgery is less appealing. To allow healing of the BK amputation in situations in which distal bypass is no longer an option. The optimal conditions for an isolated profundoplasty are widely patent inflow and a good distal profunda runoff beyond disease proximal profunda. Longer disease segments are more amenable to profunda bypass. The hemodynamic criteria assessing the resistance across the knee joint have also proved useful in predicting the clinical success of profundoplasty in particular patients. Associated mortality and morbidity are low, and morbidity mostly commonly due to lymphatic leak or other groin-related issues. Now coming to external iliac anastomosis, there are certain circumstances, however, in which performing a IOTA by iliac bypass remains advantageous. Patients with a hostile groin cases from previous surgery or radiation therapy, for example, are likely to better serve by this option. And are patients with obese diabetic patient with an intertriginous rash at the inguinal keys అంటే పేటెన్ ప్రాక్సిమల్ ఇలియాక్ ఆర్టరీస్ ఆర్ ఆల్సో బెనిఫిషియల్ కెన్ ఆల్సో బి గెట్ బెనిఫిషియల్ విత్ దిస్ ఇలియాక్ అనాస్టమోసిస్. ఎక్సలెంట్ ప్రీ ఆపరేటివ్ ఇమేజింగ్ అండ్ ఇంట్రా ఆపరేటివ్ కన్ఫర్మేషన్ ఆఫ్ ది సూటబుల్ అనాటమీ ఆర్ నెసెసరీ ఇఫ్ వన్ చూజెస్ దిస్ రికన్స్ట్రక్టివ్ టెక్నిక్. ఇన్ మల్టీ లెవెల్ అక్లూజివ్ డిసీజ్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ఆఫెన్ డిఫికల్ట్ టు డిటర్మైన్ వాట్ సర్కమ్స్టాన్సెస్ కన్కామిడెంట్ వర్సెస్ స్టేజ్ ఆర్టరీ ప్రొసీజర్ షుడ్ బి పర్ఫార్మ్డ్ ఇన్ అసోసియేషన్ విత్ ఇన్ఫ్లో ఆపరేషన్. The impact of synchronous SFA disease on the aortoiliac revascularization remains controversial. Some reports indicate that similar patency rates between patients with or without SFA occlusion, whereas others have reported long-term lower patency rate with SFA occlusion. If an atretic or prohibitively diseased profunda is present, in addition to severely diseased SFA, infra-inguinal bypass is likely to be necessary to ensure sufficient outflow for the graft patency and the perfusion of the foot. Diabetic patients with multi-level disease were no more likely to be required subsequent infra-inguinal revascularization after a inflow reconstruction than were non-diabetics. Further, although 80% of the patients with claudicans and both inflow outflow disease manifest symptomatic improvement with aorta bifurcal grafting, some studies indicate that as many as 2/3 have some degree of persistent claudication. No single criteria mandates a combined procedure, however, severity of distal ischemia is the most probable important factor to be considered. In deciding whether a staged approach is appropriate, the patient's ability to tolerate a prolonged operative procedure must be weighed against the potential risk of wound and graft infection resulting from redissection in the groin and risk of progressive tissue loss during initial recuperative period. When it is performed with several teams operating simultaneously, concurrent inflow and outflow revascularization can be completed in a timely and safe manner. Associated renal or mesenteric artery occlusive disease. Coexisting renal or mesenteric disease at the time of aortic reconstruction is challenging decision that warrants careful consideration. Multi-drug refractory hypertension or ischemic nephropathy believed to be a potentially reversible functional component on the basis of a thorough diagnostic assessment, a simultaneous repair of significant renal occlusive disease may be indicated. Introduction of a potent new antihypertensive and growing application of percutaneous interventions have significantly impact on the renal artery disease. Advocates of an aggressive treatment approach say that clinical deterioration seen with the progression of the untreated renal artery disease increasing safety of combined aortic and renal reconstruction, the patient can be taken directly for a combined procedure. Those who favor more conservative approach believe that increased surgical risk does not offset the potential clinical gain. Combined repair is appropriate when access to renal arteries arise from the diseased aortic segment. Simultaneous revascularization is more controversial when the functional significance of the renal artery stenosis is uncertain or it is thought to be clinically silent. The more common reconstructive approach is aortorenal bypass from the aortic graft with either a prosthetic graft or a saphenous vein. In selected cases, in situ thromboendarterectomy, endarterectomy with re-implantation onto the aortic graft or extra anatomical splenorenal or hepatorenal grafting may be proven preferable. A favorable response to hypertension reported in 60 to 70% of the patients undergoing combined revascularization and improvement in renal excretory function reported in 33% patients. Perioperative mortality for simultaneous aortic and renal repair have consistently been in 5%-6% range in comparison to 1.7% to 0.7% for those undergoing renal and or aortic reconstruction respectively. With regard to basal artery occlusive disease, strict attention to preservation of the inferior mesenteric artery usually suffices to prevent postoperative mesenteric ischemia, and simultaneous revascularization of the celiac and SMA is rarely required. Balloon angioplasty and stenting playing increasing role in mesenteric artery occlusive disease. Iliofemoral bypass. Management of unilateral iliac occlusive disease remains controversial. The potential options include standard aortobifemoral, aortounifemoral, iliofemoral bypass, extra anatomical femorofemoral bypass, and a variety of catheter-based or endovascular therapies. Each option has vocal proponents and is associated with some real and therapeutic benefits. If unilateral disease is largely confined to the distal common iliac and external iliac arteries, iliofemoral bypass offers a useful alternative. A patient with occlusive disease involving the entire common iliac artery are likely to be better candidates for aortounifemoral or aorta bifurcal bypass procedure. minimal invasive approach, reflecting the minimal invasive approaches in other areas of surgery, the technique of performing iota-bifurcation bypass grafting through a shorter midline incision, mini laparotomy, which is less than 10 centimeters and without displacement of the small bowel is performed. Laparoscopic techniques to treatment of IT lung disease. Some studies performed a hand-assisted laparoscopic technique with smaller incisions, whereas others have advocated the use of complex laparoscopic and robotic-assisted revascularization. Morbidity mortality rates of laparoscopic bypass procedures compared to open reconstruction are similar. Lower rates of gastrointestinal and proximal pulmonary complications have been noted. Laparoscopic surgery has the minimal incidence of incisional hernias and adhesion-related bowel obstruction. Although long-term patency of the laparoscopic bypass have not yet to be defined, intermediate results compare favorably with those of open iota-bifurcation bypass. Results of iota-bifurcation bypass and endarterectomy. The short and long-term results of both endarterectomy and iota-bifurcation bypass have generally excellent, particularly in a recently published series. When endarterectomy is performed for disease limited to the short segment, distal aorta and iliac segments, 5-year patency is around 95% at 10 years, and between 85% to 90% and at 5 years 95%, 10 years 85-90%. Perioperative mortality is around 1%. Comprehensive experience with iota bifurcation grafting in the mid 1950s through the 2000 have indicated that overall 30-day mortality rate was 4 to 4.4%. Several current era studies report operative mortality is only nearly 1%. Increasing age, pulmonary disease, and low volume hospital setting predict higher perioperative mortality. The 5-year primary patency of iota bifurcation grafting between 85% to 90%, and 10-year patency 75% to 85%. Age has proved to be a significant predictor of outcome. In one report, primary patency rates at 5 years were greater than 95% for patients older than 60 years, but only 66% for those younger than 50 years. Complications, we have early and late complications. The reported overall morbidity range from 17 to 32% after aortic surgery for occlusive disease. Cardiac complications are the most common cause of mortality. Pulmonary complications are also common and are most likely to occur in the elderly or those with COPD, and a significant smoking history or poor preoperative nutrition status. Adequate pain control, preoperative diuresis, strict attention to pulmonary toilet and other important measures to prevent development of pneumonia and progression to relatively benign alveolar collapse to more extreme degrees of pulmonary collapse. Acute renal failure after aorta iliac reconstruction for occlusive disease is relatively uncommon in patients with a normal preoperative renal function, even when suprarenal clamping proves necessary. Adequate hydration and avoidance of repetitive aortic cross clamping and perioperative hypotension are valuable prophylactic measures. Less clear is the benefit of adjunctive use of mannitol and furosemide to trigger diuresis before aortic cross clamping. Our limited ability to alter the natural history of acute tubular necrosis or the effects of hetero emboli results in some inevitable progression to dialysis dependence. Those patients with a pre-operative creatinine concentration greater than 1.8 mg per deciliter are at much higher risk of this complication. Ureteral injury during dissection, graft tunneling, and perioperative and retroperitoneal closure can usually be avoided with careful and diligent surgical technique. Spinal cord ischemia, particularly devastating complication in infraranal aortic surgery, and one that is thought to be potentially preventable. The central component of prophylaxis is preservation of hypogastric perfusion. However, gentle technique to minimize the risk of hetero emboli and avoidance of perioperative and postoperative hypotension have also been important. Fortunately, this complication is rare, occurring only 0.3% of reconstruction for aortic iliac occlusive disease. Bleeding complications associated with aortic endarterectomy, particularly for extensive disease, were partly responsible for waning popularity of this technique. With modern suture and patch materials and less extensive disease typically repaired in current era, bleeding associated with endarterectomy has become a lesser problem. Postoperative hemorrhage is relatively rare event, occurring only 1 to 2% of the patient due to a greater awareness of bleeding disorder, better intraoperative anticoagulation and blood product management, and improved hemostatic properties of the grafts used. Bleeding points in the anastomotic suture line are the aortic or femoral. After the release of aortic or femoral clamps, can be effectively managed with a repair sutures reinforced with a felt bridges. Replace the clamp before placing any necessary repair stitches under tension to prevent extending the defect and worsening the bleeding. Thromboendarterectomy measure walls of the infraranal aortic cuff are particularly thin. A previously positioned sleeve of the graft is advanced over the suture line, can act as a prophylactic bolster. Intraoperative venous injuries can occur during dissection between the aorta and vena cava or from tear from a lumbar vein. Such injuries can be controlled with a judicious tamponade. A number of sealants, glues, thrombin-based hemostatic agents are now available to help control troublesome diffuse ooze and persistent needle hole bleeding. Delayed bleeding may occur in postoperative if postoperative blood pressure is appreciably higher than the pressure at the time of closure. Other complications like intestinal ischemia after aortic reconstruction being reported in 2% of the patients. The involved segment is usually rectosegment, and that is and the cause is multifactorial. Sacrifice of the primary or the main collateral source of perfusion to the colon during reconstruction and perioperative hypostension leading to insufficient perfusion and atheroemboli are the causes. If compromised bowel perfusion is recognized intraoperatively after the creation of the end-to-end anastomosis, inferior mesenteric catheter reimplantation is indicated. Intraoperative detection of the ischemia can be difficult, and all of the various techniques of doing so have their limitations. In addition to direct visualization and visualization, interrogation of Doppler flow along the anti-mesenteric border, measurement of IMA stump pressure, and administration of intravenous fluorescein have been used. Given the frequency and delayed representation, maintaining a high index of suspicion and having a low threshold for performing sigmoidoscopy in the early postoperative period is critical in avoiding potential catastrophic colonic perforation. Late complication, we have graft limb thrombosis, iatrogenic fistula, graft infection, and anastomotic pseudoaneurysm. Graft thrombosis most frequently encountered late complication seen in 30% of the patients in some series, in which the grafts were observed for over 10 years or longer. Occlusion of the entire graft is relatively rare and usually seems from placing a proximal anastomosis inappropriately low in relation to the renal arteries, with subsequent progression of the proximal atherosclerosis. More commonly is unilateral limb thrombosis, often due to progressive intimal hyperplasia at the distal anastomosis or progression of outflow disease. Flow can be restored with aggressive efforts using special thrombectomy catheters designed to remove the chronically adherent fibrinoid thrombus. If inflow is successfully restored, the revision of the distal anastomotic site with a profundoplasty or extension of the graft may prove necessary. If more extensive progression of the outflow disease is identified, or if extraction of a distally propagating thrombus is unsuccessful, addition of an outflow graft may be needed to ensure patency of the revascularized limb. False aneurysms, anastomotic false aneurysms seen and as a late complication in 1 to 5% of the patient. Causes are being weakening in the suture as a result of structural fatigue and fabric degeneration, undue tension, poor suturing techniques, focal weakening of the recipient arterial wall after endarterectomy, infection even in the absence of obvious clinical signs, most commonly staphylococcal species are the most common causes. Femoral anastomotic false aneurysms are most common and typically manifested as slowly enlarging asymptomatic loin bulge. Proximal anastomotic false aneurysms are often discovered incidentally during a radiographic evaluation or come to attention when they rupture. Given the potential complications of thrombosis, embolization, rupture, repair is generally recommended for femoral false aneurysm larger than 2 cm or aortic false aneurysms greater than 50% of the graft diameter. Treatment usually consists of a debridement of the degenerated tissue and placement of a short interposition graft. Prosthetic graft infection, most feared complication of the aortic reconstruction given its associated high morbidity and mortality. Diagnosis is by combination of clinical suspicion and computer tomography or isotope labeled leukocyte scanning, with the groin being the most common site of presentation. On occasion, exploration is needed to confirm or refute the diagnosis. Preventive efforts include strict adherence to sterile technique, particularly in the setting of infected distal ulcerations, and timely administration of preoperative antibiotics. Once the infection is diagnosed, graft excision is usually indicated. Iatrogenic fistula, potentially devastating late complication associated with iatrobiphenyl grafting. Erosion of the proximal aortic suture line through the third or fourth portion of the duodenum. Although the fistula between iliac anastomosis or the small bowel or the colon are also described. Commonly present as a small self-limited herald bleed, presages a large gastrointestinal bleed which may be massive in the nearly a third of the cases. Classical triad of gastrointestinal bleeding, sepsis, abdominal pain is seen only in minority of patients. Diagnosis mainly by CT scanning, endoscopy or angiography. Management is similar to that of graft infection. Extra anatomical bypass and graft removal are usually required, in addition to repair of the involved gastrointestinal tract. Prevention measures like dedicated efforts to ensure adequate tissue coverage between the graft and the overlying bowel before abdominal wall closure are important in preventing highly lethal complication. Patients of low surgical risk with disabling symptoms from limited to the iliac femoral segment, surgical bypass is an appropriate option. With the current levels of low perioperative morbidity and mortality, bypass can be undertaken safely and with the expectation of a long-term patency. Thank you, sir.